Hey, you. Yes, yes, you. Look into the mirror. Do you see that person? That blobby little head thing? When I touch my face, it kinda does that too. So, is that me? Am I that thing? Why do I feel like myself? And why am I talking in the first person?
And whose voice is in my head? Whose voice is in my head?
Thank you. I knew I was Emmy material. I just hope I didn't scare you too much to introduce you to Coco. She is a Western Lowland gorilla, just like Harambe. But unlike in the tragedy of Harambe's killing, Coco's rise to fame tells a lot about ourselves and our own intrigue about human identity. Hanabiko, also known as Coco, was born at the San Francisco Zoo on the 4th of July in 1971. Hanabiko stands for the Japanese word to mean the fireworks that was going off when Coco was born. But the world got to see the real sparks when she would meet an interesting human student, Francine Patterson, or Dr. Penny. Penny got to adopt Coco as a part of her doctoral thesis to explore the linguistic capabilities of a gorilla. The idea was simple: see if Penny could try to teach American Sign Language to newborn Coco and report back with her findings. Coco picked up a few gestures at first, like eat and more, and quickly learned dozens and then hundreds of terms over the next couple of years, baffling scientists around the world. The story of Penny and Coco's most unique relationship spread like wildfire in the media, but what surprised them more was her growing intelligence. Okay, you might be wondering what does this story has anything to do with the idea of human self, and that's a valid concern. But let's try to nail this idea a bit better before we move on with the story. When you identify yourself, your collective thoughts, and call yourself to be yourself, what are you really doing? I mean, does my dog think the same way about herself like I do? Well, sure, we may never exactly find an answer to that, but my dog seemed to be pretty aware of herself when I call her name.
But wait, isn't she just conditioned to do that?
Well, yes, she is. I guess. Welcome to the messy world of evolutionary psychology and philosophy. The only advice I'm gonna give you at this point is to not get yourself too deep that you can't get out quickly. This video is not about the philosophical idea of human consciousness. As I said, this stuff is like quicksand. So let me just briefly hit you with the three ideas of human self and run away before I get hate mail from evolutionary psychologists. First one, subjective self-awareness. This is when any living organism has a bearing of its behavior to recognize itself from a giant lamppost. Like the time you walk your way home being completely wasted after the Christmas party, or like a bacteria sensing its environment. Second one is objective self-awareness. This is like when the next day you see your sorry self in the mirror and kind of recognize yourself in the reflection. To be a bit more specific, this is an organism's ability to be the object of its own attention and reflect on itself and model other animals' behaviors in relation to itself. I think cogito ergo sum, the most famous quote by René Descartes, to capture this idea pretty nicely. Only few animals known to be able to do this besides humans, like chimpanzees and orangutans. But interestingly, not gorillas. We're gonna get back to that in a bit. So the third and last one is more abstract. This is called the symbolic self-awareness. It is similar to the objective self-awareness, but a bit trickier. In my opinion, the words of the earlier 20th century American satirist Ambrose Bierce handles this complexity well. Cogito, cogito, ergo, cogito sum. I think that I think, therefore I think that I think I am? So to push my previous metaphor a bit further, the so-called symbolic self-awareness is when you question all your life decisions leading up to this hangover and why you have to behave in such despondence against your wishes, hopes and dreams, and then make a resolution not to drink again and go to the gym every other day. So what is self? Well, all that is self, but clearly there's a distinction between different types of self-awareness. So this is where I drop my own self-awareness and bring on my trusty timeline and spinning globe. Cue that music, Coco. Okay, let's jump back to around 70,000 years ago. This is around the end of the Middle Paleolithic period. Basically, that means that humans have been making stone tools for a while, and it's like this bridging point towards the Mesolithic period. So last week, we met our ancestors coming out of the forest and developing behavioral modernity towards the Upper Paleolithic period. If you want to follow that story about why humans turned out to be the last member of our species, there'll be a link at the end of the video. Now, we will pick up at the point around 70,000 years ago when either Homo erectus or our Homo sapien ancestor is facing a global catastrophe. A super volcanic eruption in Indonesia causes a global volcanic winter, and our species faced a situation of extinction. A small band of some 10,000 people survived this devastation, to whom we all can trace most of our genetical ancestry. Now, this is a relatively new and very controversial theory, and it is not by any means certain at this point. There are other ways to explain these changes, such as famine and plagues, but the evidence points us to some interesting changes in our genetic makeup caused due to several genetic stressors. Okay, this is where things get a bit interesting. Some 20 to 30,000 years later, we find our ancestors sharing the territory with Neanderthals in Europe. And unlike the Neanderthals, our ancestors were expressing themselves with psychedelic lion/man figures, making flutes out of vulture bones, and vandalizing caves with their art. Totally like my goth face back in high school. So something is clearly different with us at this stage. What really happened? There are a few ideas. Since somebody's bound to TLDR this whole section, let me give it to that guy first. Food, social structure, and brain structure. Happy? Now, for the rest of you, let's quickly look at what happened starting with the changes in their diet. When the earlier hominids moved from their treetops to the flat savanna, probably around the time of Homo habilis, our ancestors were casting wider and wider nets to feed themselves. And hunting became an ever-important aspect of life. See, if you're an animal munching on the leaves and fruits on a treetop, you don't have much to do other than focus on your most important task, to keep feeding yourself. I mean, the food is plentiful, but these stuff are pretty low in calories, so you don't really need a gaming PC to run that kind of software. But if you want to bring down a 400kg buffalo or an 8-ton mammoth, you better up your social game and your brain power. If you look at Homo habilis, well, they don't inspire great confidence. Not in their stature, their speed, their strength, their ferocity, or even their mental equipment. And the answer to this ultimate success can only lie in the very helplessness of that original creature. One small mistake, and the hunter is a puddle of blood. So you need to communicate your intentions with your hunting clan very efficiently. Think about this.
Small groups of humans were hunting mammoths when even the most vicious predators today
hardly dare to bring down an elephant cub unless they're desperate. So community was everything. Weapons were everything. And this new hunting way of life has some bonus and unexpected side effects. The childbearing mothers can now afford more safety and time, while the men take all the risks. This means that longer gestation periods are now possible and the mother and the clan can take care of the offspring for much longer, explaining why human childbearing takes so long and why they can afford to take so long to mature. These bigger games bring excess of calories, which mean a few other things. For one, if you are artistically or in any other way gifted, your dad might not force you to become a hunter. There's enough to go around for craftsmen and priests. Now this obviously means art and religion. All this socialness and calories cannot be supported without more complex processing power and more communication. And we see this in the rapid expansion of Homo erectus's brain size and changes in their larynx that coincided with the increased need for verbalization. In this new environment that rewarded speed, fast and accurate acting enhanced their adaptive fitness. And this usually means that more automatic cognitive processes are better at speeding up things. Think of cheetahs. But this is until you have new and different stimuli. And this is probably the case with our nomadic Homo erectus. The move from the forest to the savannah and the new hunting lifestyle that kept them on the move meant that they were presented with not only practical problems but social dilemmas. I mean sure, you kill the prey, but now you gotta figure out how long it'll take to take the carcass to camp, how heavy it is, how long before it starts smelling bad, if you should butcher the carcass now or later, how long till your baby can go without food, and if your mate is gonna be happy about your slow decision making. I mean also remember, women had their own problems to deal at home. Taking care of a baby in the Stone Ages was no walk in Walmart. But I'm not gonna get into it now, but these mothers were dealing with unimaginable conditions with zero baby proofing. All these need for complicated analysis were putting pressure on our poor ancestors on an unprecedented level. So automatic self-awareness doesn't just cut anymore. You need to question the question. You need to think about the prey and yourself and about yourself in relation to the group and your clan and ultimately yourself. So where does Coco fit in all this? Well, if you were paying attention, gorillas were thought not to possess the objective "I see myself in the mirror" capability. If you think about it, that would kind of make sense. The whole need for such thinking did not arrive until we started to separate from our ancestors in the forests.
Who is that?
But look at this.
Think me there.
That is Coco objectifying herself in the mirror and now speaking about herself just as I did in the beginning of this video. That should have not been possible. The only explanation we have is that gorillas don't have this need in the wild and they might have suppressed this capacity to some extent. But we have not tested gorillas in appropriate laboratory environments like in the case of chimps, because unlike our closest relatives, gorillas suffer more from isolation from their species, such as in the case of Coco, who was never able to find a mate despite her explicit interest in having babies, so we might never know the answer to that question.
Other animals are also capable of identifying themselves in the mirror. An easy test is to put a marker on an animal's body and see how they react in front of the mirror. Like in this case, this Asian elephant is using this mirror to remove his makeup. And this magpie is trying to remove a yellow colored dot from her body. Or this dolphin frustrated with her new markings on her belly.
They all show the same behavior you would expect from a human child figuring out the mirror. But some of these animals show some advanced vanity we would only come to expect from ourselves. These male Asian elephants are apparently very impressed with their tusks, and these dolphins can't get enough of their curvy bodies. The dolphins actually show the most amount of interesting behavior, like making these funny faces like I do when I'm all alone. Dolphins diverged from hominids too long ago to make that a factor, unless you put on the tinfoil hat to believe that we descend from dolphins. But the extraordinary similarities we see in dolphin societies is probably a result of convergent evolution, like in the case of this dog. Psych! I apologize. This is the extinct Tasmanian tiger, which also had nothing to do with tigers. It was a marsupial. So more closely related to wombats and kangaroos than dogs. Or tigers? Seriously, who came up with that one? Oh right, the stripes. I get it. The reason for such similarity is that the thylacines lived similar lives to canids like jackals and coyotes. They were hunters. Dolphins have remarkably similar lifestyles to that of our savannah-dwelling ancestors. From hunting to migrations to food, dolphin brains are much larger than ours in absolute terms too. Living inside water means that they can't exactly talk the same way we do. However, their echolocation works in a similar way to that of Coco asking for food here. These dolphins use their echolocation beams to ask for the type of food they require by hitting different targets, which is a much tougher task than pointing to a treat while you're stationary. On the basic level of neurons, neurons themselves do not have any cognition. But evolutionary pressures somehow brought about this emergent property or illusion in ourselves that gave us a tremendous advantage in survival. What we can hypothesize from this is that dolphins and other cetaceans, just as gorillas, have not faced similar evolutionary pressures to ask that weird question, who am I? But next time, we're gonna ask a bit of a different question. I'll see you next time. Hey guys, but before you go, if you like what I'm doing here, please let me know by hitting the like button. And do consider to subscribe, that would really help. Thanks again.
When Coco was looking at the videos to pick her potential mate,
Coco love.
It was a thumbs up, thumbs down reaction.
Oops, she just turned the power on. Is that what you were telling me? Bring.
You like Ndume on TV?
Ndume, which means male in Swahili, was the 10-year-old bachelor who caught Coco's eye.
Oh my goodness, a big kiss!